In a land as rich in paradox as India, it is no surprise to find that one of the country's most interesting architect is an Englishman. Though after close on 40 years of pioneering work in different parts of India, Laurie Baker can hardly be called a foreigner.
Born and brought up in the West and educated there, how did you adopt over Indian tropical conditions? I mean, your designs, how did you adopt?
Well, actually it was, I was forced to adopt because I came back to India doing work for leprosy patients, an organization that had a lot of homes, leprosy homes, all over India. And during the war, we had discovered new drugs which made it possible to treat leprosy. So my job was to convert old buildings that had been mere asylums and homes into modern hospitals where people could come and get treatment and go back home again. But funds were limited. So I came out as a British architect, having been trained in England and done some work in England before I came out to the East. And I found that many of the materials that I was supposed to deal with, I'd never heard of. Laterite, for instance, the stone we have here, I'd never heard of such a thing. And then all this mud and thatch and bamboo, they were entirely alien to me in what I had been trained in school, in the School of Architecture. And I found that engineers and architects were no help. They didn't help me at all over these problems. So I found the answer in the indigenous buildings. Wherever you went, there were these buildings of mud and thatch, and I would find out how they built them, what were the special tricks of the trade. And then I tried to adapt my English teaching and my English upbringing, which of course was more or less universal. The principles of construction, as you know, apply anywhere. So, but I had to go from the bottom end in India, as it were, and come upwards rather than try and impose what I had learned.
Sir, I know that you're a Gandhian. So how far you're able to convey this Gandhian philosophy to your profession?
Well, I would qualify this statement of yours that you know I'm a Gandhian. I met Gandhi several times while I was waiting for this boat to go back to England. And it's because of him I came back. It was at the height of the Quit India movement. And of course, it's quite wrong to tell Laurie Baker not to do a thing because he immediately does it. So, so I came back here very much believing in all that he was doing and all that he was saying. And I think his general principles, in whatever line, still apply very much to all of us anywhere, and particularly here in India. So, as he pointed out to me almost in the first time I met him, you are bringing knowledge and qualifications from the West, but they will be useless unless you try and understand our needs here. And the greatest needs are in the villages and for the ordinary people, not places like this, Bombay or wherever.
Whether it is a small town or a village or a big city, in our country, a common sight is the all too commonplace concrete structure. The advanced building material, concrete, has given rise to these structures, which has a genealogy inherent in the process of modernization.
Regarding the housing problem, I know it's a big question to be asked, How do you see the housing problem in India? I mean, for example, the statistics.
Well, of course, statistics are always very frightening unless they're used to show that we needn't get upset about things. We hear, for example, that there are anything between 20 and 30 million families in the country without anything at all in the way of shelter. Now, I see the big problem as being we are trying to tackle it with our PWD and modern methods of reinforced concrete very much to the fore, and at the same time we have only a very limited amount of money to do each house. It is supposed to be something like 6,000 rupees. Now, we all know what you can do with 6,000 rupees in the reinforced concrete line. You could just put one slab in a kitchen and you've finished. So we have to think in terms of indigenous methods of building and local materials, and then we must upgrade them and use our 20th century know-how to use them intelligently and acceptably so that we can actually build for 6,000 rupees a small house for a family who has nothing. So I think we as architects, if we want to help in this problem of supplying the missing housing to the country, we've got to start thinking small. And I'm very concerned that we don't really show any signs of developing an Indian style of modern architecture. If you took a modern building from where Peru and Germany and England and China and South America and an Indian one, put them in a desert, would you be able to pick out which was the Indian one, which was the Peruvian one? I don't think we would. They all look the same, which I think is a pity, because our ways of living are very different from those of the people in Peru or China or wherever else it is. And the building should reflect our ways of living, our culture, what we want.
Kerala has a distinctive architectural style, both in its religious and domestic traditions. Peculiarly suited to its given climatic conditions and dictated by the available materials of wood and coconut palm leaves, it was perfectly attuned to the ways of life and habits of a society. But now, it is inevitable that the landscape in all its environmental aspects has changed. The living habitat also has to make constant readjustments with the present. The functionalism and rationality implicit in this international architectural style, when transplanted into our own context, is at variance with our living environment, habits and ethos, thus bringing in a style that is drab, deadpan, and impersonal.
Every district you go to is a different style of indigenous local architecture. In that style shows how you can use the local materials, the materials right there on the ground and growing around the site where you're going to build, how you can cope with the local climate, the special winds, the special rainfall, the topography, whether it's rocky or sandy or marshy or whatever it is. All these things are reflected in the indigenous architecture, but not in our modern stuff. Exactly the same thing is put in a desert as it is in a marsh or in a forest or in a city or in the country. It's all the same and totally unsuitable. As far as the people are concerned, the people who have nothing just want something. And they must have a roof, they must have water, they must have sanitation, they must have something like a smokeless chulla or some way of cooking and using fuel for cooking. These are their basic problems. And we as engineers and architects are not applying ourselves as we should do to these problems. This is the hostel for the Centre for Development Studies. There are all sorts of people living behind it. Sometimes they're not here, so we wanted this is a veranda, three verandas, one on top of the other, and they need it closed in for the periods when it's not in use.
I see. What is this? Why this wall is there?
Well, you see, actually, this is just a 4.5-inch wall. It's 3 stories high, and it is load-bearing, carrying the weight of the floor. You see, if you've got a wall like that, you can either knock it over, or you can crush it, so it's all crushed. But as soon as you do that, then neither can you knock it over, nor can you crush it. So this is just the simple packing paper principle. And because it goes in and out, it can carry the whole weight. Then, of course, these are instead of windows. This doesn't cost anything. In fact, it costs less because there are all these bricks missing. And you get very good lighting, as we'll see when we go inside.
This is a very interesting corner here.
This is so that you don't have to cut bricks. Every time you cut a brick means money. Only a little bit, but when there are 1,000 of these cuts. Yeah. Also, of course, this is a strong surface. It doesn't let in the water, whereas a cut brick would absorb a certain amount of water. This is about 15 years old. People are always worried that it will absorb moisture and it will grow moss and lichen and all this sort of thing, fungus. But you can see it doesn't, simply because there's a good big overhang.
Yeah.
All our traditional roofs protect the walls as well as the whole house. And it's only when buildings are exposed to pouring rain and moss that they grow the moss. This one you can see is perfectly dry. This hasn't been cleaned or whitewashed or anything like that. And yet it's 15 years old and looks as good as new. Now, you see, you've got all the light you need from that.
Yeah.
It's carrying the weight of the roof. It's a lighter roof than the ordinary roof. But no problems at all. No water comes in. And you've got this. Then you see this, the same with the staircase.
Yeah.
You save a lot of room by using a circular staircase. And actually, that's hollow. Again, it's this principle that you can is very, very strong when it's a hollow like that. There's no need for a solid one. If you've got a small solid column of reinforced concrete, then these steps will go to a narrow point. But here I can walk up and down quite easily, you see.
So most people, they talk about the durability, the lifespan of these buildings. So you mean to say they're structurally stable?
Yes. This is a problem that is always coming up. I mean, the problem is people doubting. A long time ago, when I was brought up, of course, we just had this rule of thumb, how thick a wall should be, how thick a slab should be, how high, all this sort of thing. Now there is no excuse at all for any building being unstable or, as we say, it won't last. Because we can calculate. We know the compressive strength of the brick. We know the compressive strength of mortar. We know the weight of the room above. We know the thrust up. So we can calculate anything. What is inexcusable is over-designing simply because it looks thin. This is only a 4.5-inch wall, but because it's in a circle like that, you can calculate what the compressive strength is, how much weight it will take. So this brick will last exactly the same time, length of time, as any other brick built in any other wall. You were talking about the fact that I don't use plaster very much. There are two or three reasons. The one is that plaster all over a building accounts for 10% of the total cost of the building. So if you don't need it, why waste 10% of the cost? Then, as you saw in the other corridor and the rooms we were in, there was no plaster, but some people say, but we don't like the look of bare brick, which isn't very nice. So we have to have plaster in order to put color wash.
Yeah.
But that's not so. You see, this is just the ordinary bare brick with colour wash or whitewash over it. And that is adequate. Then for ventilation, permanent ventilation, the jali is very useful because it lets in both light and air. Then if you want some light, here in India we have to cut out the light very often. In many of our modern buildings we have huge sheets of glass, huge windows, and then we spend a lot of money keeping the sun out. So we have a big window for the evening. You can open it completely, or you can have a chick or whatever you call it. And the same with the flooring. The cement flooring and the mosaic flooring is very cold, and particularly for we older people who get rheumatics, it's not at all good. But these old-fashioned bricks are very comfortable to walk on with the bare feet and to sit on. They're essentially an Indian commodity, and we don't follow them, we don't use them any longer.
It has some pattern.
Yes, it gives a texture and a pattern, and very easy to keep clean. This cleanliness bogey is, well, it is a bogey. Things are clean if you clean them. They're dirty if you don't clean them. Whether it is a tile floor or a mosaic floor, it's the same.
As we all know that architecture, sculpture, music, they're related to each other. Being interested in the Western classical music, how do you relate your designs with music?
You make me think of the young lady architect who was asked, what are the three arts? And she said, music, painting, and fancy pastry making, of which architecture is a subdivision. No, I was brought up in the Western classical musical tradition. My father was a choir master, my mother was an organist. So I had it laid on very thick, and it goes right through my being. I've often heard of architecture referred to as good architecture as frozen music, but I don't agree with this. I think one of the wonderful things about Indian architecture, for instance, is the design to make a vital use of light and shade. The deep shadows and the brilliance of the sun on different textures of materials. And this is changing the whole time. Throughout the day, the shadows change their place and the color changes and the richness of the texture changes. And again, I don't think that we are taught this sort of thing here. We just put up a building that looks is almost bound to look the same whatever time of the day. But I think architecture is not frozen music, but music. I think in terms of Bach's fugues, for instance, which are very logical. You have a certain basic theme, and you elaborate on it and on it, and you can encompass everything you want within that theme. So that with our building, we want housing. We want at least three sleeping places where mother and father can sleep, girls can sleep, boys can sleep. We need a cooking place. We need a bathing place and all that sort of thing. And the variations of those simple combinations, then we have all the different materials. We have mud, we have burnt brick, we have stone, we have wood, we have bamboo. That also brings in a whole complete pattern which fits in with the other. So I think it's very much akin to music. And music is normally very ordered and systematic. You follow a set of rules, not the sort of rules that you mentioned earlier, the bylaws, but rules of what is good, what is sensible, what is functional. And in this way it is very much like music. I think probably my musical upbringing has helped me, but I never think of it in that way. the question of aesthetics or beauty, I personally think this is where many of the Gandhian ideas come in, that it is, beauty is all related to truth. And if we use materials making use, bringing to the fore their natural characteristics, then what results from the use of timber or from brick or from mud or from stone, that itself is beautiful. It's only when we think in terms of beauty as being something that is applied afterwards. We see it very much around us these days. You can make any sort of a building, whether it's functional or structural, structurally stable or not, doesn't matter, as long as you paint it green and pink and purple and put on pebble dash and all the rest of it. Whereas that is nothing to do with beauty. Yeah. It is just an applied bit of colour.
Structure.
Quite right.
Laurie Baker's passionate involvement with the problems of shelter has been recognized by the Government of India and has appointed him to several bodies concerned with housing. In 1986 October, he was conferred the title Member of the Order of the British Empire. He attends to the work without any contractor or assistance or even an office. He does everything.
And we have to look to the actual needs of the people in India today. And then we have an incredibly beautiful country. And it is full of all sorts of very, very beautiful indigenous styles of architecture. No other country has the range of beauty and interest that we have. And I think it's most important that we don't destroy this, we don't take away from it, we don't foul it up, and that we follow on in this tradition of creating beautiful things in India. And then I think to do that and to meet the needs of the people, we've got to stop thinking big and go back to the idea that small is beautiful. And we should put all our efforts into a lot of small things rather than in all of us wanting to build one or two big masterpieces. The need for of the country at the moment is for all this housing and all the other buildings that go with housing. That is preventing our coming up our standard of living and our education and our economy of the country and so on. So I think this is very important. And then I think, most of all, we should be thinking and designing as Indians, for Indians, in India. Finally, I think, I don't know how to say it, but I think it is a shame that we as architects, as a class of people, the professional people, highly trained, are doing so little to meet these very great needs that the country has at present. We must never forget this fact that there are at least 20 million families without anything that can be called architecture, even a hut. And it is to our shame that we allow that figure to increase and not get less.